end will be taken from the perspective of the injustice done to Igbo people. Either this injustice is legitimate enough today to break the country, it's a different kettle of
fish. Sorry, Najai, if I'm taking it from this other side of the divide, I mean, from your perspective, we are all entitled to our opinions. The people who are agitating for Biafra are entitled to their opinions, so they shouldn't be stopped. But if I were to ask you this question, Barrister Ahmed Dada, if you looked at the presidential media chat, the president was very sad about the issue of Biafra, but he sounded like that is not really... It's not really enough to move me. I don't really see that as so much of a problem. I would handle, we would together collectively handle Biafra. Now, he has talked about what happened from the past. They've been agitating from the past. There's been several issues. But I want to dwell on the present. Okay, the present Biafra agitation has been, you know, agitated by, has been reinstated by Nnamdi Kanu on the basis that the Igbos have been marginalized. But the president came out on the media chat to say, how have they been marginalized? Is Ikachukwu Igbe not an Igbo man? He started making mentions of different persons who are from the Igbo clan, who are members of his government. If they are saying they are being marginalized, that present day 2016, would you, do you, what's your take, what's your stand on that?
This is my own.
You know, keeping things fall apart, like things that happened in the past, let's dwell on the present.
This is my own interpretation as a stakeholder in this enterprise called students of history. There's something fundamentally wrong with the geographical function that we call foundationally, there's something absolutely wrong. I'll put my argument in analogy. Very same cerebral members of this society have been calling for sovereign national conference to enable all the diverse tribes to look at themselves and say, look, this is how we are going to cohabit. And some segment of the society says, no, we don't want anything sovereign. It's a no-go area. You must be bounded together by force, whether you like it or not. I don't care about your feelings. This marriage must work at all costs. I step on your toes, you want to complain, it doesn't matter. We are married. We have to stay together. Doesn't work. You know, I said, analogically, it is fathers that used to disown their children. But you know, the fear of the federal government of certain group of people is that, oh, when we go to a sovereign national conference, it's going to split Nigeria. That means some people will say, I don't want to belong to Nigeria any longer. Then if there's a problem in the family, and the children are the one agitating for a meeting to resolve the problem, and the father is saying, no, I'm scared that when we get to that meeting, my children are going to say they are no longer my children. That means there's something fundamentally wrong with the way the father has been treating those children. For you to be scared that your children are going to disown you. It's not just the Igbos alone. How do you have the OPC come about? In the north, you have the Boko Haram. What are they saying? Everybody has an ideology.
But I sound like that. Sorry to interrupt you. In every section of the world, in every nation, there will always be divides. There will always be people who would be antagonistic of government, people who would antagonize policies and so on. If I were to look at it from this perspective, I mean, looking at Biafra, if at the end of the day, okay, we go for all of these sovereign meetings from these sovereign committees. Yes. Now, we're already aware that the European Union is interested in the Biafra issue.
Yes.
Let's assume, supposedly, worst case scenario, there's Biafra. Are the Biafrans ready to have a society of their own, to have a nation of their own? Do they have everything it takes to sustain a nation? Because Nigeria has been on for like how many years, and we know what we've been through as a nation. Up until 2016, we're still not stable. We're still trying to find our feet and our balance. So if people are agitating for Biafra, away from personal gains and sentiments that, yes, I achieved this, what else do they, what else?
Because like I said, once the foundation is faulty, then there's no amount of engineering that you bring that will rectify the distorted structure. But there's something fundamentally wrong with the enterprise called Nigeria. And we must be honest enough to say the Niger Delta militants are there, the OPCs are there, the Biafrans are there. Look, nobody wants Nigeria divided, but the terms and conditions for being members should be clearly spelled out. I want to run. You are saying because you don't have the capacity to run, I should slow down. Sometimes, he rightly pointed out, the Igbos are very enterprising. You can't take it away from them. Somebody said if you go to any part of this world and you don't see an Igbo man, run away. Very enterprising, very energetic. An Igbo man will go to that Balogun market, sell in the morning. In the evening, he will be at the motor park, travel all the night to Nija market, buy things throughout the whole of the night, the day. In the night bus, he's back to Lagos. The following morning, he's back in his shop. What am I saying? There are these different ideologies. If the Yorubas have their ideology, if the Yorubas, the Igbos have, the Hausas have ideology. So until you bring everybody to a round table and say, look, let us define our terms of our engagement. Look, for example, a situation where somebody from the East or the West will score 240 in JAMB and he applies to university. He's not admitted simply because he comes from an advantageous state or environment. And somebody else in the same country scores 140. And against admission, so that you cannot, look, it's not, there's something wrong. Everybody has been agitating those, let's go back to federalism. What Igbos are basically asking for is, let me run my life the way I want to run. If I believe I can fly, don't tie me down. That is what is happening. This energy, the young men that are crying for Biafra and all the rest of it, is just unutilized and unchanneled energy. Because the environment is suffocating. Look, if you watch, look at documentaries, watch CNN, see how young, able-bodied men that should be developing this nation, crossing the Atlantic, because the environment is suffocating and choking. When you over-centralize a system, that is what you have. The president of this country virtually touches every, is the most powerful president in the whole world. I say it, quote me, the most powerful president is the president of Nigeria. You talk about police, he's there, you talk of PFCC, you talk of immigration, talk of, and he's virtually every. If you see the parastatal that the federal government, the president has to approve appointment and all the rest of it, you want to wonder that this guy must be a magician, he must be a superman.
Just a moment. Taking from his clue, you know, we've come to see the foundational issues causing this agitation. But recently, the EU says that they will support the Afro struggle for self-determination with a condition of no armed struggle. What do you think is the implications of this support to the unity of Nigeria?
The EU actually is, I have the letter. From the EU. Let me read it out.
But that was what you have on the papers.
I thank you. That's Mr. Levy, writing on behalf of the UN, the EU Secretary. I thank you for your letter dated 22nd December, in which you seek support from the European Union High Representative for Foreign Affairs and Security Policy for a petition on Biafra. Ms. Mogherini has instructed me to reply on her behalf. Second paragraph. The EU has a long-standing, multifaceted relationship with Nigeria and engages in regular dialogue and cooperation with the government and civil society. We follow all political developments in the country very closely. Protection of human rights and fundamental freedoms remains a priority for the EU, and we encourage the authorities in every occasion to respect such rights. As far as questions of self-determination and changes to national borders are concerned, they are best regulated in accordance with established national law and relative customary practice. Yours sincerely, Peter Shadder. Now, I don't believe maybe that is directly endorsing. I don't, maybe my English is poor. But let me agree with them. The foundation is very weak. But again, if Barrister Dada checks other countries, they have their fault lines. Every
country, as much as Nigeria.
As much as, look at Spain. Every time Barcelona is playing, you see people singing Catalonian anthem. To the extent that the UEFA got angry one day and said they will punish. Everybody has issues in their respective countries. You understand what I'm saying? But the fact of the matter is that the Sovereign National Conference, it was genuine. I must admit, under military rule.
Samuel Achai, let me ask you this question. From everything you've read, I mean, you've talked about the fact that EU and Nigeria had long-standing economic ties, you know, multifaceted bilateral ties and so on. But if he mentioned the fact that the foundation is wrong, at this point in time, what EU is saying, is this what we want EU to say, or is this what is favorable for us? If we were to profess solutions to this, fine, we do know nobody wants Nigeria to be split. America did profess that Nigeria would cease to be one nation in 2015. So many persons said that. A lot of people are not in support that Nigeria should cease to be one nation. So if you were to profess solutions from the EU, what would you rather want to see from the EU? Would you want to see the EU put all of us on the same table, sit down,
wine and drink? Towards the end of his contribution. The center is criminally, underline the word criminally, too big. Let me give you an instance. You know that we pay lip service to some of these fundamental issues affecting us. See, I will mention it, they know themselves. At the time when they were in opposition, they were every day agitating for true federalism. Am I right?
Yes.
Now they are in power. Have they mentioned it again? No, because they are now in charge of their superintendent over the Commonwealth, which they were not in charge of that time. Like he rightly said, if the president of Nigeria wants to be making appointments, he'll be doing that in 2019, because he has about 5,000 appointments to make.
But what would you rather want to see from the EU?
What EU should advise Nigerian government to engage, not even Biafran agitators alone. Biafrans, those in the South, the OPC, they are a one consultative forum. Everybody has a different idea about how Nigeria should be run. Why? All of us have agreed. Okay, there's one agreement among all of us. Okay, we agree. We don't want to break. But on what terms are we going to stay together?
Okay, you mean at this point we should bring into play the meeting they had during the last administration, bringing out
the political conference.
Yes.
Do
you think they should implement it now?
We can bring... See... the problem, like the Reverend Father Martin Azakuka said, the problem with Nigeria is we play politics with them, battle everything. Everything, if I want to walk from this place to that door, we want to play politics with him. The way you walk, you have to look at the political implication of the way you walk. Who you look at the political implication. The point is that we want to play politics, virtually everything. People will play politics.
And this is very sensitive.
And very, very sensitive. We have to go to that report. And you know, people have been referring to that report.
But this government seem not to want to look into it.
For political reasons.
Okay.
Because anywhere, look at this.
But you, in your own view, do you think is the way forward, looking at this, that report?
I've not even studied the report, but I know it made, how do I put it, a very stronger fundamental ramifications about how the country should be run. And one, there's another report that Nigerians
and
are
how we should.
We should. Steve Orosayi report about devolution of powers. You understand? A situation whereby, look at VAT, look at so many things that states don't have control over. You're a governor elected by maybe a state of about 5-7 million. You don't even have control. You can't even give instruction to the police commissioner in your state. If you're in a different political party with the president, if the president can use that police commissioner to undermine your government. In very serious, and everywhere you are, the president does not even know what is happening in certain local governments in your state. You know, you are probably from that local government, you know the nitty-gritty, you know why people were fighting that local government. Maybe it has been on for the past 60, 70 years, over what they are fighting, over common boundaries. But for political reasons, the president can give instruction to the police commissioner, do this, do this, do this. And when anybody said, I think the commissioner was acting on this policy. That is number one. People were asking for the police 10 years ago. You know, those who have asked. There was an interview recently. So they now asked one of those agitators. He said,